The Holy Gospel for the seventh Sunday after Easter comes to us from the Gospel according to St. John, reading from the 17th chapter, beginning with the first verse.
Glory to you, O Lord.
After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave to me I have given to them, and they have received and know in truth that I came from you. They have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. Now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in the name that you have given me, so that they may be one, as we are one. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Heavenly Father, and from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. A very long time ago, I had the privilege of working and serving in an office of social services. It was a welfare rights center wherein we helped people who had difficult time receiving social services that they required. My specific task was, in those days, was called advocate. That was before the days of ombudsman. That was before the days of any kind of assistance that stood up for people that had been rejected or refused. And so somebody was hired that was able to help. And the fellow that was in charge of the organization was a very interesting man. He was a person who himself had suffered a great deal and had been homeless for a time. He had certain issues that he struggled with throughout the course of his life, and was as good as he was in the running of this center, primarily because he knew where people were at. He could relate well. He wasn't as polished or as professional as many people that you'd see, but really, really good at what he was doing, really good at connecting with people on the street. But the person who really made the agency successful was the individual he had chosen as a kind of a office manager, if you like. She was an exceptionally gifted person. She could do everything. She knew pretty much all of the laws off the top of her head. She knew the people that we were working with personally. She had connections with them and had been there for a very long time. She knew the social service agents, the government agents with whom we had to deal on their behalf. She knew them personally as well, and she behaved in a way that was exceptionally professional and really just made life so much easier. She was good at what she did. But there came a time, as we became more and more successful, there were more and more people at the door, and things got busier and busier, but she became more tired, as you can imagine. She was overtaxed. She was tired. Small, almost inconsequential, but small mistakes began to creep into her work. Nothing overwhelming, but little things that were really uncharacteristic of Mary. She never, ever made mistakes, and now all of a sudden she was making little ones. And the boss, who had come to consider me as one of his confidants, came to me one day and says, you know, I don't know what to do. Mary's slipping. And he was beginning to worry that she was getting too old. And I said, she's not getting too old. She's just tired. Give her a break. Give her some time off. He said, I told her to take some time off, but she refused. She believed, and part of this was true, she believed that if she were away for too long, things would crash and burn, things would fall apart. And though there is a sense in which we did rely on her tremendously, nobody is indispensable. And I said to him, you've got to tell her that she needs to take this break as much as we need her to take it. She needs to see this kind of as an interlude that God is providing for her so that she might rest from all the stuff that she's been doing and get ready to work even harder. And I don't know how he did it, because he was not really very tactful in the way that he approached things, but he convinced her, and she took time off for, I think she was gone for almost 3 weeks. She went away maybe to Hawaii or something like that. And when she came back, things worked exceptionally well once again. The rest was good for her. Our text today comes at a time, a point in Jesus' ministry that's significant. This is the last chapter in a series of chapters in the Gospel of John that we call the Farewell Discourse. Chapters 14 through 17 represent kind of a little bit of a summation of everything that Jesus has taught. It's a little bit of a summation before the next step. You see, we have sung the song and are in the process of celebrating Ascension, where Jesus goes up into heaven. So there is a time in his ministry where there's a bit of a change, particularly for his disciples. Think about it for a second. How ministry had gone for them. They were going about their normal lives, and Jesus called them, one after the other, in different ways, in different times. And they began to do some incredible things. They began to see some incredible things. They began to be taught to think in very different ways. Love became a standard of thinking rather than judgment. Love and forgiveness became the criteria with which they were taught to understand and to look at people. A very different way of thinking for them. And they began to celebrate and to embrace this. And on top of all this, this Jesus of Nazareth was considered to be the promised Messiah, the king who was to come, that would somehow or other take the place of King David, that would somehow or other liberate the people of Israel who were oppressed by the Romans, who were confused by their own religious leadership, who had been corrupted on so many different levels. This man, Jesus, now, with this fresh, exciting message of God's love for all of humanity, was changing the world, and they were exuberantly excited over the whole thing. But then, all of a sudden, everything changed. They were on their way into Jerusalem for the Passover, and were met with shouts of adulation. Hosanna to the King who's coming. Praise to the Lord, and so forth. And they just joined in with all that excitement. But within the course of 1 week, just a few days, all those shouts of adulation were changed to cries of condemnation. Rather than saying Hosanna to the King, people were now shouting, crucify him, crucify him. And they were witness, not to the coronation or the advent of a new king, but rather the execution of their master. It was a time of horrible sorrow. All of the hope and the joy and the excitement that they had coming into the city, it was gone. There was nothing left. For at that kind of time, there is no joy, there is no hope, there is nothing left. They were drained. At least it seemed like that. Then in a couple days, 3 days, a strange thing happened. You see, Jesus had been crucified coming in the Sabbath, and his body could not be completely prepared. The preparation for his burial could not be completed until after the Sabbath was over. In other words, until dawn on the Sunday morning. And some people had gone up to the tomb to find the body, to prepare it. And when they went there, not only was the tomb open, But the body was gone. And in the Gospel of John, there was a report of two angels sitting there listening to what it is that they're saying and looking at how startled they are and saying to them, don't be afraid. It's Jesus for whom you look. He is not here. He is risen. Tell the disciples that he'll meet them. So they scurried off and told the disciples, and with great incredulity, the disciples came running to check, and they saw the same thing. And then there was the report of those who had been on the road to Emmaus that had encountered Jesus on the road, and they were just freaked out. That which seemed to have no hope all of a sudden was met with hope. So the ministry that they'd been involved in that came to such an abrupt end on Good Friday now was in a bit of stasis, in a bit of an interlude, one of God's intermissions. And so for a period of time, Jesus was with them on the earth once again, teaching them, summarizing, and praying for them, that they might be strengthened for the journey that lay ahead, for the mission in which they were to be involved that lay ahead of them. And he wanted them to be empowered. And he prayed to God that God would be with them so that they might be one as he and the Father were one. God's interludes are like that. An opportunity is given where the same kind of activity isn't going on anymore. The same kind of excitement isn't pushing things anymore. Everything is kind of in suspended animation. They're waiting. They're waiting to see what will happen. They don't know quite what to do. They're waiting and they're resting. Not only are they resting, but God is preparing them for the work that lay ahead. For when Jesus left this earth, he left his ministry to them. The work that he'd been doing, he left to them to continue. Brothers and sisters, in this life, there are times for all of us when one of God's interludes comes upon us. Times of transition and change. When we feel a little bit out of sorts, when we feel like we're not just rolling in quite the same way that we used to. Maybe we're graduating from school and moving on. That's a scary thing. Because your daily activities, which have been defined for so very long in very specific ways, it all changes. And what's even worse is you've got to decide what you're doing after that. It's confusing. Or maybe you're changing jobs, perhaps because you've lost your job or you've simply decided to move on to another job. And there's a time of interlude where you just don't know what to do with yourself. Perhaps it's a broken relationship. The death of a loved one. Any one of these things can make us feel absolutely lost. But when these moments come, it is important for us to see these as God's interludes, moments that we have to rest, to be strengthened from what has been behind us, to be rejuvenated from the energy that we've expended in the past, and to be strengthened for what's coming in the future. That is true for all of us. With respect to ministry, brothers and sisters, you and I are called upon in the same way. With respect to life, we are called upon to understand that God gives us moments to rest from the past, but there are almost always moments that we are encouraged to prepare for the future. Sometimes we lose our way in this thinking, and we begin to think in ways that are askew. A simple example. The very holiday that we celebrate this week. It saddens me to see how many people treat this as just another day off. Oh good, it's a long weekend. Well, yes it is, but why is it a long weekend? Well,
it's May.
Must be Memorial Day. We are given an opportunity to think about what's gone on in the past so that we might prepare for the future without ignoring the important piece there. Brothers and sisters, the reflection that we do upon that which has gone before is so very important because it does and can strengthen us for the future. You have a ministry opportunity. you have a challenge before you. Now, some of you may not necessarily be going through any particular changes or transitions at this time in your lives, but you have. But that which is clear is that your ministry opportunity, your ministry calling, your vocation now is to serve God specifically and intentionally by serving God's people. That is what Jesus did, and that's what Jesus gave us to do. That's what Jesus gave the apostles to do, the disciples who were Jesus' followers. We are called upon to serve those people as best we can, to know that there is hope. To know that though things that have been in the past are sometimes wearisome and burdensome and feel like they drug us down, that there's something exciting in the future. For God is in control. Human beings lose sight of that. We forget that God is in control. We forget what God has done for us in Christ Jesus. We don't think about it. And we allow ourselves to wallow in self-pity and sorrow. But I'm here today, brothers and sisters, to tell you what you already know. That in Christ Jesus, God has won the victory for us. Because of Christ's resurrection from the dead, we have life, and not even now death can scare us, for we have life, and we have life eternal. But here's the thing. There are people in this world who don't know that. There are people in this world who've closed their eyes to that, whose sense of loss and sorrow and anguish is so profound that they scarce can see any light at all. But God has given them a blessing. And the blessing that God has given them is you. Because you're there and you can share with them what you know that God has done for them. Jesus made such a proclamation about his disciples. He shared with them everything that they needed to know. And he encouraged them to go out and to share with others what they to give to others what they've been given. We too are encouraged to do the same thing. As you leave this place today, brothers and sisters, in this time between the death and resurrection of our Savior and his ascension into heaven, this most wonderful of God's interludes, remember that you have been given time to rest and to reflect and to regroup and to prepare. Prepare for the excitement that is to come. To prepare for the work that is ahead. To prepare for all of the opportunities that you have to share the good news. So go out from this place. And when you encounter someone who is lost and sorrowful, and they may not even look lost and sorrowful, but you come to know they are. When you encounter such a person, share with them first God loves them. God loves them so much that God has done for them what they in all their effort cannot do for themselves. God has given them the gift of life. Help them to know that so that they too can celebrate the future with you. Go out from this place and share the good news that God's interlude provides us with a moment for rest and an opportunity for. Let us pray. Good and gracious Lord, we give you thanks this day that you provide for us moments to rest from the wearisome troubles of life, the challenges that are before us, the challenges that we've gone past, the difficulties that we face. Strengthen us through all these things. Strengthen us and heal us from the pain that we felt and the sorrow that we've experienced. But more than anything, Lord, prepare us for what's to come in the future. For we have a mission in this world, not to remain stuck in the mud of our past, but rather ready and willing and prepared to be agents of transformation in the lives of people who don't yet know you.
Give us courage, therefore, to share with them the good news that you are our King and theirs, and that you've done for us what we can't do for ourselves, and that in you they too have salvation. Strengthen us for that proclamation today and forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.